Here we go. Surf's up. It's always up here, though, right? Surf's always great here. We don't have to worry about the surf report. And you never know what you're going to get here. Truly, and just like I wake up in the day, I don't know what I'm going to get. And today I got a earful and there's some really amazing stuff going on. But dharmically, let's start off by saying that the help is greater than the problem. The help that we have is greater than the problem that we have. The problem that we have really is just continuity fear, familiarity bias, okay, expectations, fear. When we start losing our expectations, the source of our expectations, we say, oh, that's false, that's not true. We say, oh, I don't know what to expect, I don't know what to expect, and we get real scared. So we run back to the falsity again, and at least then that reestablishes our, you know, expectations the way they used to be. Now this is our trouble. But this trouble is an extremely severe trouble. Because what it does is it keeps us in this dream-like state of wishing for doubt, wishing that, to try to cast doubt upon ourselves, and thereby casting doubt upon God reality. And therefore, what we're doing is we're pretending like that we're greater than God, or we can be greater than God. We can be the prime creator. This is what it's all about. This is what we're trying to accomplish with this so-called world, this feeling we call a world. It's really just a feeling. There is no world at all, actually. There's not a world. There's not a caused world. The way that we believe the world exists doesn't exist at all. Now, there's still all this appearancing. Yeah, this appearancing is arising. But it's not what we wish it to be, actually. It's all free. It's all unrooted. It's all... We can go on and on. But the gist of it is, okay, we have this severe problem, really severe problem, and so many defenses defending it. But the help we have is greater than the problem. So it overcomes the problem, and that's the end of it. It wins the problem. We lose interest in the problem, and it's all good. We don't have to search out the problem and all its variations. We just need to lose interest in it. And the help we have in losing interest in it is stronger than the interest we have in it. It moves us away from being interested in doubt. At least the pretend doubt that we're pretending, as if there's some kind of process. Oh, I've just noticed the sunset here was just dark and cloudy, and suddenly this band of bright pink showed up right in the midst of these dark clouds. That is so amazing. Wow, that happened really fast, too. Anyhow, welcome from California, Northern California here, Bay Area. We got some issues here with mudslides and roads collapsing, and there's more issues in Northern California with the dam issue. I haven't looked at the news about it, really. Someone told me about it today. I don't follow news stories. I pay no attention. But if something's brought to my attention, then I figure, well, there's a reason for that. And then something else was brought to my attention. I said, uh-oh. This is pretty, a little bit scary what's going on. And the constellation of stuff that's being brought to my attention has a pattern to it. So I'm like, when you're just out of it and you're open-minded, you don't care, you're not, and then stuff just comes into your awareness and people tell you stuff, and there's a pattern to it all, you have to figure, well, this is grace of God saying, okay, I have something you might want to put your attention on a little bit here. But the help in overcoming problems is stronger than the problems. So we don't panic here. We keep faith in the grace of God here. It's certain to be stronger than any problems could possibly be. This is a fact. I'm trying to get the adjustment on this lighting, but it gets pretty involved, all the warnings I've had. I realize I've had a series of warnings. And then today, I saw a scenario that these warnings could be relating to. I wasn't sure, well, what's, I don't quite understand what all these warnings, it's getting better and better, the sunset. Wow, what all these warnings are relating to? Then suddenly, today, it was mentioned to me. I said, that's probably it. That's not good. It's not good at all. Especially because I've been warned about specific events in history in the past, and they've come true. They've come true. I was born with extreme precognition, where I could pretty much just say whatever's going to happen in the future. I'd be able to just say, well, that's going to happen, this is going to happen, this is going to be right, be absolutely right. But people didn't like this, and they thought I was weird, and so I just tried to, my whole life I've tried to get away from that, actually. I predicted the Boxing Day Indonesian tsunami, the terrible tsunami. I predicted that. I put up a website about it. I did maps. I did GIFs. I did interact. I did all sorts of stuff. I pinpointed the exact intensity of it and the devastation of it and everything, but not a soul responded. I did. It just didn't get out at all. I just. People just don't want to hear about it. Predicted 9/11. Predicted 9/11. Very, very clearly predicted it. And was, but this, but I didn't do anything about that. I just said, uh-oh. But what's the use? Nobody will listen. This is a fact. Nobody listens. Pretty weird, huh? They could be warned about stuff too, but apparently it throws, gives them a nice doubt, to have stuff happen. Like, oh, I didn't expect that. I really doubted that would happen. So it casts doubt. Whereas for me, when stuff happens, like 9/11 happened, I sort of shrugged my shoulders and said, yeah, that's exactly what the dream showed me was going to happen. And that was it. I didn't go into all the intensity of it and everything too much. And then the tsunami too, the same thing. I didn't pay any attention to it hardly. I said, okay, how strong was it? Understood. Okay, that's exactly what I was shown. Exactly. I was shown a dream exactly what happened. So, this is a little different here. I haven't been shown in a dream exactly what's going to happen, but I've been shown a lot of indicators. But what's the use? Even if I pinpointed everything perfectly, I guarantee you nobody would listen. So, but I almost feel, there's certainly some problems in Northern California right now, and could be some more. I was shown in a dream. I was in a dream. I was watching this television broadcast, an emergency broadcast on television, and it was going over this map of Northern California, and it was showing all these places that were either had been flooded or were in danger of being flooded. But I didn't believe it. I said, that's impossible. So I thought it must be a war, a war map. I figured that must be a war map. So maybe some invasion of California or something. But it definitely, I thought it was symbolic, but what it was literally told me was all this water problem with water damage and stuff. And I just said, that's really not really plausible at all. So I kind of stored it away, the dream away, and said, well, but it was so explicit, on the broadcast, the maps and pointing out and the areas were all shaded and shown exactly what was happening. The people evacuated this area, evacuated this area. It was all about these evacuations. Areas had been hit and all these evacuations that were taking place. That's what I was shown in the dream. Now we have like 130,000, some say between 100 and 200,000 people being evacuated from Northern California from Lake or the Oroville Dam. And it's like, huh, it's interesting. But still, I say, well, that's doesn't account for the scope of what I saw. What I saw seemed to be, quite bad disasters. But it, I guess it could get to that if it, spills over, the lake overflows, and the people downstream from that's a bad thing, because right here we have a lake. A very small, tiny lake in a reservoir, and the floodgate is—it's they have to open the floodgates wide to let all the water out, and so you can see from the floodgates downstream how strong the river is just letting stuff through the floodgates, and it's extremely strong. And it's like, wow, the amount of water this little reservoir and little lake are putting out produces this raging stream, a raging river like 200 yards wide. And so I'm thinking, you know, if Lake Oroville overflows, I mean, the amount of water is just like, you know, you could have a raging river miles and miles wide, actually. I mean, I don't know. It's second largest reservoir in the country, I think. Of course, it would come over off the lip of the dam, but it would, you know, it spread out. There's a lot of water could be pouring off of there. So that's quite amazing. But the dreams I've had in the past indicate something in the Bay Area is going to happen. And I don't see how water damage could happen here. It's ridiculous. But various dreams I've had. One dream was pointing out an earthquake, and I was able to pinpoint the dream exactly where the earthquake happened in the dream. It was the Hayward Fault, because the Kaiser Permanente building, in the dream I saw it, and I looked it up, the headquarters of Kaiser Permanente is in Hayward. And I was also shown, I was working, and I was asked to do an errand at work, and I did it, and it was kind of a very odd errand. And that was just before the earthquake hit in the dream. And just recently, a couple days ago, last week, I did this errand that was exactly the errand I saw in the dream. And the parallels were just, you know, right there. And I said, uh-oh. That got me thinking, right? It got me thinking, like, wow. Then, and before that, I had this dream of the Virgin Mary frantically and insistently warning me about earthquakes to come here in apparently Northern California. I don't know if it was the world or Northern California, but I'm assuming it was Northern California. She's just very, very insistent, pointing out, I think she was like pointing out these faults and pinpointing everything. She showed me everything, the intensity, everything. It was very, very detailed. She was very emphatic about earthquake problem here. And I just kind of said, well, I mean, I don't know what that's about. Is it true? Is it not true? You know, I don't know. So these are, you know, this is just various experiences I've had. The one that's really an eye-opener, well, they're all eye-openers, aren't they, actually? They're all eye-openers. A while back, like 2.5 months ago, I got this really strong push that I needed to go somewhere. And it was really amazing how it happened. I was aware that I'm getting really, really strong guidance to go someplace. And ultimately, it ended up being this dam. And I did some bunch of taping there, and I went back several times. And in doing so, I became familiar with this dam and the story of this dam. And I looked it up on Google. I just was interested. I said, why am I being sent here? And there's so much emphasis on this dam in my psyche. I was getting, I realized, very strong push. The guide had put me right there and said, you've got to pay attention to this. I said, well, what's the big deal? I didn't understand. I was very confused. What's the big deal? I don't see anything important here. Well, I looked up the dam, and it said, well, this dam is going to be drained because the dam is seismically unsound. It's an earthen dam, and there's a lot of instability in it. And they say the tests that were done on it say it's very unstable, and an earthquake could absolutely cause it to collapse and disintegrate. And if there was water pressing against this dam, all the water could collapse the entire earthen dam. So the I think it's a federal mandate. It could be a state, but it might be federal, saying you must drain this lake of water and you must fix this dam right now. You have to do it real fast. Well, one problem, the drought, the 5-year drought we had, which was extraordinarily severe. And so I believe they got some sort of slack on draining the lake, and because of, we needed the water for the drought. It was kind of, they were kind of caught in it tough spot. At any rate, and the drain for the lake is just this one pipe that goes, it starts a river, or a creek or a river, yeah. And but it's just one pipe. I mean, it takes a long time. It's a big lake. It takes a long time to drain a lake that size. That is for sure. A little outlet like that. And then I was shown, I was told to go look at the spillway. I looked, I examined the spillway really carefully. I actually got up on it and did some taping on top of the spillway. So I was really casing out this dam really carefully from some inner intuition. Now here's the problem we have, is that suddenly we get like record rains in January, and more rain to come in a few days. It's supposed to last like 8 days of precipitation, rain, showers, but you know, water coming down. And a lot of the reservoirs are like full or overflowing, and this one has filled up. They had it drained way down, but now it's like 93% or something. It's almost full, and they can't drain it fast enough. So with more water on the way, it's likely this lake is going to be, you know, totally full with all that massive weight of water pushing against this earthen dam, which has been said to be very unstable. And it's like emergency. We had to fix it. It was like really, really vital that we fix this. What's the big deal? Well, an earthquake. If an earthquake struck, which they do strike the Bay Area, and it was, you know, a strong enough earthquake, that could really collapse that earthen dam. Uh-oh. So I get this information, and I didn't know it was full. I said, oh, really? And then suddenly said, wait a minute, you know, I started remembering all these dreams and say, wait a minute, this is not good. Now, the Hayward Fault is a periodic fault. It's very consistent throughout history. They've been able to go back, and scientists have been able to pinpoint that the fault, on an average, they average it every 200 years on the average. And yes, plus or minus a little bit here, a little bit there, but it's really consistent. That fault slips very consistently throughout history. So we know it's going to slip again. There's zero reason why it won't, right? And we're like overdue by, I think, like 17 or 18 years, something like that, over the 200-year mark already. And so if you go back in history, there's not many times when it goes over that much. So like you would say, we're overdue. The Hayward Fault is overdue. Okay, so the worst-case scenario would be we have an earthquake now, and that dam collapses, releasing all that water. And I just talked to a guy, I just mentioned to the guy, I mentioned to a couple of people today, like, yeah, there's a problem, with possible problem with the dam. And he says, what? He says, I live right there, right beneath it. And I say, uh-oh. I said, you didn't know about this? He said, no, I didn't know anything about this. I said, well, that's not good. I wouldn't live there right now. There's no way I would live there. So right now is a danger period for that dam and lake. Pray to God that the earthquake doesn't happen right now, a strong earthquake. Now, you know, if we can get to summer, they can like work on draining it. I don't know how long it'll take them. It might take them a long time, but they got to drain that lake. And it's a dangerous time with that lake at near capacity. If an earthquake struck now, when it's at full capacity, it could collapse it. I mean, the amount of it's not a concrete dam at all. It's just earth, dirt, when rocks and dirt, and the shaking of an earthquake. You know, could once water gets through the cracks. See, once it cracks, water gets through the cracks, and then starts widening those cracks. And before too long, poof, this is how water works. So it's a really precarious situation if we get an earthquake. And then this dream, Virgin Mary, you know, Virgin Mary dream, urgently telling about earthquakes that are to come. And the other dreams that I've had about, you know, this earthquake I experienced on the Hayward Fault and the dream, and then and a sign of when it would be. And I've already had that sign now last week. Just like, uh-oh, you know, wow, that's pretty, pretty, a little bit, this is wowish is what it is. I say, wow. And with my history of accurately predicting catastrophes and various events, that's another factor. I said, well, you know, this is not unusual for me to become aware of this kind of stuff. I've pinpointed earthquakes to the very day, actually. But what's the use? Who can you tell? Nobody. Scientists won't listen to you. I don't have any, you know, way of... being a psychic is not my thing. I mean, that's not what I'm interested in at all, actually. I'm not interested in... But I just do it out of compassion, thinking like, well, those poor people, maybe if they were warned, it would be helpful, but who will listen? I don't you know, think that hardly anyone would listen at all. But I'm just mentioning this because it's, you know, it's not... There's a probability of a certain extent if it's a perfect storm. And it's funny because people are mentioning to me, like they say, you know, it seems like perfect storms are happening more and more and more and more in the world, which is true. I've noticed that. So a perfect storm would be really troublesome here for the Bay Area, South Bay area, because if that dam collapsed, all that water in that lake is coming out, a lot of it, fast. And it's just going to rampage north and south. I imagine it would go both directions. And I think I looked on the predictions, I mean the estimates of what happens if that did happen, some geological survey, and it shows a path of destruction that is just extraordinary. It would be just an absolute extraordinary disaster for the South Bay Area. Who knows? I might even be in trouble. I don't know the extent. It could just spread. It could just be absolutely insane. So, and that might account for the dream I had of the emergency television broadcast of showing you, you know, the danger areas and evacuation areas, and maybe the dam was like starting to collapse, and they gave an emergency broadcast telling us where those who should evacuate. Something like that. Or, you know, I don't know. You know, it's just, it seemed like some had already evacuated and then they were extending the areas or something like that. It was a crazy situation. I couldn't understand it, but a collapse of the dam might account for that. A collapse of a dam could account for that. Possible. So, you know, I'm not asking for this information. It just gets given to me because I can piece it together. But that's not my interest. My interest is in apex yoga. Apex yoga. The lake, Anderson Lake is the name, in Morgan Hill, California. Anderson Lake. So I'm a little like, wow. I've had so many warnings, like, you need to get out of the Bay Area. Maybe that's why. We're in the South Bay Area, you know, and a lot of friends would be right in the way of that. You know, a lot of people I know live in the area, which could very well, I mean, the Guadalupe River is the floodplain, and that water would likely be following that floodplain out to the bay, San Francisco Bay, the South Bay. I think the water that comes out of that reservoir does feed into the Guadalupe River. I believe it does. I can check that. So it would flow north into the bay, South Bay. So that amount of water released would just spread out and just, you know, have a huge swath of just complete devastation all the way to the bay. That's what they predict it would happen if it doesn't get fixed. So it was supposed to be fixed years ago. Uh-oh, another trouble in California. Who's minding the store in California is the question, really, as this Orville Dam thing is in trouble. You know, they're worrying about all sorts of other stuff, aren't they? Which I have been trying to tell, you know, whoever listens, hey, our priorities are screwed up. Totally screwed up. Not taken care of. Someone's not minding the store properly. A whole lot of people are not minding the store properly. Some are, but they're being thwarted in lots of ways by those who are not. So this is just, it's a possibility. I mean, it certainly is worth noticing because of these external. Now, I have a friend who was actually maybe took the first photograph of the collapse in Skyline Road, the collapse of the road. He was driving home, and they stopped, and there was one other car there, and they said, "You can't go, it's collapsed." And he went out and took a picture of it. They let him take a picture of it, and I got the picture, maybe the first picture taken of it. The whole road just collapsed. And Highway 17, another mudslide today, I believe. I heard it's the road's being undermined underneath the road. So there's a lot of stuff happening in Northern California due to massive rains. And one certain trouble spot in Oroville Dam, and then a second possible in Lake Anderson. So, and who knows what else is going on? It's a dicey time right now, very dicey time, not unexpected at all, actually. So I'm pretty calm about it. I says, "Oh, of course, you know, I said time of turmoil is coming, and it is. It's right here, right now. It's all over the world, isn't it?" But, so, I'm just, you know, okay, that's just grist for the mill and saying, okay. But good luck, you know, trying to do anything about it. You know, sometimes you just have to let God, let the help help you. And those who don't want to be helped, well, you can't force it. And if you speak up about this, what do you think the real estate people would do? They'd lynch you, you know? I mean, and the homeowners, they would ruin their value of their homes. And people are investing like crazy in the South Bay, thinking they make a killing on you know, the price of their homes, investment going up in the homes. It's just a, you know, incredible frenzy taking place here. Massive building, developers just developing like crazy here, apartment buildings, etc. Right near Guadalupe River, that whole area. I mean, that's the last place you would ever want to invest. And so, of course, they'd be absolutely furious if you said something like this, because people might get scared, and of course they wouldn't buy there. You know, people would realize this is like the worst place I could ever possibly buy. So you're under this massive pressure from those who, you know, for money to not be heard. And this is the way it is around the world, right? That's why people say the money is the root of all evil. You tend not to listen to guidance, prophetic guidance. I'm surprised anyone has ever listened to prophetic guidance throughout history. It's said that Nineveh finally listened to Jonah, but you know, that's what it says. You know, it's pretty surprising. But I mean, the best case scenario would be that the dam starts springing some leaks, and then people are given time to get out of there. There's warning, and they're able to get out of there, rather than an earthquake, you know, hitting it suddenly. That would be the worst scenario. So hopefully, you know, because right now, people shouldn't be living there under the circumstances. It's a very risky situation. We know the Hayward Fault. Everyone knows. Scientists know it's going to pop. Probably soon. Everyone knows that. So you just add up, and it's not a good place to be living. It is not. And of course, nobody tells you that. Even this man who lived right near the dam didn't even know about it. He was very surprised to hear this. Yeah, money, 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 money. When there's money to be made, people shut their mouths, don't they? So it's you get this information from a pauper, and I spent my last dime on this cardboard box right here. I don't even have anything for Valentine's, you know. It's like, wow. But because I was told to do this, I said, I got intuition and advice and very clear guidance, and I was very surprised. So when you do stuff that you would never think of doing, because you got tremendously clear guidance and that everything clicked into place, then you got to say, well, that's not just me. This is coming from guidance for some reason. I don't know. You know, hindsight shows it, and hindsight has shown me that guidance is coming from a higher intelligence, a source of, you know, higher intelligence than our normal everyday intelligence. So I just started opening up this box here. Pulling out some paper. Aha! I see something. Something's emerging from the box. Wow. That's kind of cool. Cool stuff that works, it says. Cool stuff that works. Holy cow. What's this? Holy cow. Oh my gosh. I'm still pulling it out of the box. And there we go. And it's a little plastic thing, and it's a wrench here. Plastic wrench. And an instruction booklet. Aha! So this nice little plastic wrench here. And an instruction booklet. Okay, so I see that. That's cool. I like that. And then, this just came this evening from UPS. I've been waiting for it. The next thing I extract from here is a head cover. Wow. Holy cow. Pretty deluxe head cover here, actually. Quite deluxe head cover. It's got a grip on it. You actually grab it to pull the club out of your bag. That's very sophisticated, actually. Okay, so got a head cover here. Then I have this. And needs to be opened up somehow. There we go. Here we go. Just one step at a time here. Now, all day long, I was saying, I got to get through this day because I know this is coming today. And I was really tired today. I said, I just have to get through this day. And so it motivated me to keep going. But I didn't sleep last night for some reason. Okay, maybe because of these dreams I'm having, right? I mean, it's like some problems. Okay, so we have this white shaft here. This beautiful white shaft. Wow, it's a beautiful shaft. Ooh. And then we have this this nice golf head here. It's bubble wrapped. MyFly 8 technology. BioFace. E9 BioFace. Okay, so this is a golf club, a driver. Wow. Okay. Let me see, how does it look? How does it look? I just sort of hold it up here. Super stiff flex. Wow. I'm gonna have to really stomp on this one. Really, not stomp, but I mean really hit it hard, but that's what was indicated. So that's what I've been working out. I was working out today, yesterday too. So I took a couple days off during the week last week. I was really tired, but I started in again Sunday last night, hitting the abs core really hard. Really, really hard, really. And then today was the upper body, the push-ups, more flexibility, a lot of flexibility work, upper body muscle work, a lot of work. And so I'm feeling, you know, pretty sore again, but I'm practicing so I can hit this club. And It's adjustable. So we're just kind of hanging out here, and it's all good, isn't it? So this is supposed to go in here, I believe, and it loosens up a screw in the head here. And so I undo this. Oh, and the shaft starts to move. So I'm able to twist the shaft and get different loft positions. That's amazing. It's pretty easy. It's very easy to do, actually. And I can even unscrew this some more. I think that you'll see that anyway, if you can see this shaft, it you can spin it, and it shows you different loft positions here as you, and then you can put it back in there somehow like that. I got 9.5D now, which is 9.5 draw. So I can just leave it on that. That's the roulette wheel just came to rest on 9.5D. But you can go from 8 to 11 degrees loft on this. It changes the trajectory of the ball flight. So now I'll tighten this back up. And, whoops, it slipped out. It slipped out. Interesting. So you have to make sure that it stays in. 9.5D. Okay, now it's starting to tighten up. Tighten it real good there. Shouldn't slip off. So I've never done this before. I never had an adjustable club. Oh, there we are. There's the club. Okay. Very nice face. Interesting club. Wow. This is amazing. So when I got home today, I took out my other driver from my bag and put it away in anticipation that this club would arrive. And arrived it did. So this is the pretty cool. So yeah, here we go. I can hit this club. I'd have to really smash it off the tee. So really smash it. Brand new. They got it really cheap. It's amazing. It's a couple years old. But this club was really super highly rated when it came out in 2014. Reading reviews, they said this club is just, you know, toppermost. It's a tremendous amount of technology that's going to help your distance. And of course, driving is pretty much about distance. Wow. Okay. So I had to wait a long time for this, like 10 days, I think. It got stuck in bad weather, snow, I presume, back in Midwest. So, wow. And it's this amazing blue and white motif, which is what I was showing. I was showing to get a driver that had this blue and white motif. And this is exactly the motif that I was shown. And it's pretty amazing. So, somebody knows what they're doing. I've never heard of this driver. I don't really follow golf equipment at all. Haven't for a long time. And so, I was not aware of any of this stuff. BioCell Plus, Cobra BioCell Plus is what it is. Looks cool. Looks really nice. The looks of it is, wow, it's beautiful. Really, really, really beautiful. That's what people say aesthetically. It's just like, wow, Most golfers are really funny. You know, their drivers have to be black. You know, TaylorMade eventually made some white ones. Everybody's going, "What? This is revolutionary." But Cobra puts colors on their drivers, and most people, you know, the traditional say, "I never hit a colorful driver." But I guess I'm going to be hitting a colorful driver. Yeah. Wow. I don't know what loft to put on it. You just experiment and you find out. 8 to 11 gives you 3 degrees to play with. 8's, you know, low. I found I can launch an 8-degree driver. And 11's pretty high. Most are like, drivers are like 10.5. And it's supposed to be a very high launching driver with low spin. So some hit it on 11, I heard. Maybe I will. I don't know. We'll find out. So finally it arrived. I've been waiting for this, really waiting for it. And this gives me an impetus to go forward. It's something to look forward to. So the grace of God is greater than our problems. Whatever the problems may be, it's greater. The grace of God is greater. How extraordinary. So we don't really need to worry too much about what the problems are. What we need to do is focus on the remedy and accepting God's remedy for whatever it is that we're trying to cast out upon ourselves. We're always trying to put bodies in harm's way as if that's somehow cast out upon spirit. Formless, definitionless, free, perfectly free spirit. What does that have to do with bodies? Nothing. What do bodies have to do with spirit? Absolutely nothing in terms of denoting anything about spirit. They don't denote anything about spirit. Not anything at all. What happens to bodies has nothing to do with spirit. Now, here's something pretty amazing. I got this huge push to get back into golf. I quit golf a while ago, and it, I said, "Well, I'm not interested." Well, the push keeps coming, 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 coming. Finally, I said, "Okay, I'll do a few things here, there." But I said, "But, my knee is terrible. I can't play golf. It's not possible." I said, so why am I preparing to get back into golf when I have such a bad knee and it's not getting better? It's been 2.5 months. So I can't play golf. This seems really weird. But I said, well, you know what? The push keeps coming, so I just have to trust it. I just have to trust it. I said, okay, what can I do? The push is there. I admit that. So I just got to feel that the knee will get better somehow. I don't know how, because I've been treating, treating, treating. It just hasn't gotten better. Well, I went to the driving range last week, I think it was, once to test the knee out. It was kind of a little painful, actually, a little bit painful. But afterwards, it wasn't so bad. I iced it, and it wasn't bad at all. And then Sunday, I went to a driving range. And I hit like about 120 balls, and I didn't feel the slightest trouble or pain in my knee or weakness at all. And got home next morning, it's fine, nothing's wrong. And I said, "What's going on? This is extraordinary." Because I said, "Look, I'll go ahead as if my knee's going to be fine, but the knee better get fine. I don't know how that's going to happen. I'll just trust it." So I just trusted. Miraculously, somehow the knee would be fine. When I need it to be well, it's going to be well. I just trusted it. And so far, as I'm going in the direction of my guidance, the knee has been, you know, the clearing up. The trouble's been clearing up where it didn't before. And I was going to go to the beach and tape because of super low tide. And I got warned off from it, and I decided no. Instead, I'm going to go to the driving range. Super great decision, because every time I've gone to the beach, my knee flares up and gets really bad again. It's weird. Every time, then on 2 or 3 weeks of pain and concern. So I decided, you know what, it's not worth risking it. Let's go to the driving range. But then I said, well, that's going to hurt it too. I said, well, let's find out. Well, it didn't hurt it. It didn't hurt it, which is really surprising. So, as I say, everything is psychosomatic. Everything comes from mind. So I just had a feeling that if I do the right thing, the knee is going to feel be fine. If I go in the wrong direction, the knee is going to act like a break, and it's going to hurt. It's going to hurt. So getting back into golf is the right direction. A lot of signs. There's so many. I buy this Jordan Spieth. It says Spieth on it. I was a big supporter of Spieth when he first came out. I said, this guy's going to be the next great player. But then I haven't been watching golf for a year and a half or so, not even following it at all. No, I don't know what's going on. But the AT&T Pebble Beach Pro-Am is in town this weekend. But a couple of weeks ago, I bought these t-shirts. A couple of them said Spieth on it. Just t-shirts, real cheap. I just feel like wearing them. I'll just wear them. They're cool t-shirts to say Spieth, but I don't know what's going on with Spieth. And then I guess this AT&T, this some news came out, and he was leading the tournament. And I said, that's interesting. Well, he went on to win the tournament and joined some very select company. And that he's the only him and Tiger Woods have won 9 times when they were by the time they were 23. You know, before they left the year 23, and so Spieth's like 23 in 6 months or something. So those are the two guys that have won 9 times before they turned 24. They won 9 times before they turned 24. Tiger Woods and Jordan Spieth. So he's on a pretty good trajectory, actually. Really, it's quite amazing. I just happened to see these shirts were super discounted. I bought them. I said, well, it's just for to help me putting. I'll get confident because he's a great putter. But maybe he's like going to have a super great year at golf. That's what they're saying. He's saying, look out for Jordan Spieth this year. He's starting to get everything is clicking for him right now. And he's just playing fabulous golf. And he's capable of dominating. I mean, he is so good. All around. Great short game, though. Just super, super, super putter. And he's, you know, so it's interesting. For some reason, I said, you know what? Let me wear this shirt. Maybe something will happen with Spieth, and I'll feel like a pull to golf or something. Well, it's happening. Then I get home and I go to Surfline, and there's this interview with Kelly Slater, and it turns out he was at the AT&T Pro-Am. He's a great golfer himself, the greatest surfer of all time, and I watched this 20-minute interview. And it was really cool seeing Slater being interviewed and how he handles it. And I said, there's another golf connection. He actually has the same brand of driver I do. He plays was a brand ambassador for Cobra Golf. This is a Cobra driver. And here he is. It just happens to show up in Monterey, real close by here. Played for 4 days of golf. You know, if I'd have known he was there, I might have gone down. But no, I don't want to go to golf tournaments right now. Got too much other stuff going on. So, but it's really, really interesting to hear what he had to say and how he handles himself. He's very calm, very confident and calm and poised and intelligent, and it's really quite an amazing guy, actually. Very driven to win tournaments, that's for sure. And he had a bad round, his first round. He says, terrible. Haven't had a double bogey. He said, I had 11 years here, I've never had a double bogey. Like, what? Are you kidding me? How's that possible? Man, I mean, he's almost like pro caliber golfer. You know, to do that's just extraordinary. But he says, I was off. I was really off. I just didn't have it. I don't know what's wrong. I just didn't have it. Well, you know, that's the thing. Sometimes that happens with golf. So, there's another connection with golf, right? So many connections are happening with golf now that are just popping out of the woodwork, and I'm just saying, well, okay. I mean, you know, the help is greater than the problem. Obviously, my problem is no money to golf. So I just have to say, well, the help with the problem is greater than the problem. I mean, I can work out with dumbbells or weights. It's free. It's free. But as far as green feeds, no. I can't afford green feeds. So all golf geared up and ready to go. Yeah, right? So I just trust that the help is greater than the problem. It really is. That's God's whole plan. If you want to boil it down, all advice can be boiled down to just this one advice. The help is greater than the problem. That's it. That's all you need to really know. If you just believe that, you're going to be saved. Just that one, but if you don't believe this, you're not going to be saved. Repentance is like saying that the help, I admit the help is greater than the problem. I accept this is this is true. I accept it for me. And then it changes your total attitude. Total change, isn't it? Before, if you think the problem is greater than the help, that's going to be your outlook. It's going to color everything. It's like a pair of sunglasses that colors everything. But if you believe that the help is greater than the problem, that's a totally different perspective. Totally different. So, this is really important to hear this. The help is greater than the problem. And it is. It is. And those who have been saved tell us this. They say, the help saved me. And I've had a massive amount of help in my life because I trusted it. I trust it'll happen. So I'll just trust in this. I'll just trust, okay, the next step. I keep doing these steps. And, working out is fine because it's free. I do it here. I don't go to a gym. It's just free. You can always do sit-ups, right? You can always do push-ups. It doesn't cost anything. I did push-ups today. I did 50 with my hands spread fairly far apart, which is much more difficult than if your hands are kind of narrow. If you have a narrow hands, you go like this, it's much easier. But you put your hands wide apart, you go down further, the strain on your shoulders and arms is much greater. I did 50 of them, but I was careful. I did two sets of 20 and then one set of 10, and I rested a little bit in between the sets. And my arms or shoulders are sore right now. That really gassed me, I'll tell you that. Oh, well, little pun there because I did it in a gas station. But it was good. I felt great. I said, wow, that's really something. That's great. Did my kale smoothie. That's what I've had to eat today, basically. I did my wheat, wheat toasted wheat bread, peanut butter, and marmalade. And a kale smoothie for breakfast with all this good stuff I put into the kale smoothies, banana, chocolate protein powder, coconut, apricot, cherries, blueberries, all this stuff. And then I got home and I refreshed it with a whole bunch of fresh blueberries and more chocolate powder and some other stuff, pineapple chunks, frozen pineapple chunks. No, frozen blueberries. Frozen blueberries, frozen pineapple chunks. That's kind of my dinner, because I'm like 1 pound overweight, so I gotta, be careful here. And so working out like crazy, dieting like crazy, great nutrition, and taking these steps, guidance, having tremendous insights and breakthroughs. That's just life as it is right now. And I had a tough time today. I didn't wow it enough. My mind started going in all sorts of different directions, spinning all sorts of hopeful scenarios for the future. Man, I almost got in some trouble. I wasn't driving very alertly because of that. So you should really don't make any plans around your success. Just do this, whatever is in front of you. Don't project into the future like, okay, now I can do this. This is the kind of action I'm going to take. Now I have this driver. Now I can play golf with Kelly Slater or something like that. You don't want to project in that way. They asked Kelly Slater, how much would you ch do you charge for surf lessons? And Kelly's like, what? Now, Kelly's a surfer dude. I mean, he grew up as a surfer dude. He's not really a jock. I mean, he plays golf, but he's a surfer dude, okay? And they have a different culture, okay? It's a unique culture, actually. And so he was asked by Dan Patrick, asked him, how much would you charge for golf lessons? And the other guys on the set, his sidekicks, said, like, well, like $10,000 or more? And Kelly's like saying, like, what are you talking about? He's like genuinely like, kind of like, what kind of question is that? He's not really a jock. I mean, he's a surfer. Okay, there's a difference. And then he said, I don't charge. I'm free. Free. If someone wants to learn how to surf, I'll teach you how to surf. You don't charge lessons for teach someone how to surf. I mean, it's a soul thing, man. Come on. We're soul brothers, as surfers. You don't charge for giving lessons. And they said, well, could you teach me to surf? He said, of course, sure I could. Sure I could. I teach. He said, what would you do? Well, first you go out and small surf and you get a board that floats you really well, and then you learn how to paddle and wave selection, positioning, wave selection, all that stuff, and you gradually get used to it, and then you go from there. I said, of course I could teach you how to surf. It's not easy, but it's doable. Yeah. So I was looking to get a surfboard today, a foam surfboard, but they say, oh, they fall apart, you know, they're not big enough. You could get them, I guess, the wave foam or something. It's like an 8 foot board. You can get them for a couple $100 or something. Then you have to get a wetsuit. I'd get a helmet too. Too many people are getting knocked unconscious by their boards. Another thing happened in Micronesia. I mean, Slater almost died in France getting hit, his board hit him on the head and gave him a concussion, and he almost drowned. I mean, these guys, surfers are stupid. That you should wear helmets. They make them. A company, Gast, GASD in Australia, makes surf helmets. I think Mike Kerr, Tom Carroll wears them. I think he was a world champ back in the day, I think. Great surfer. He wears them, but almost nobody else wears them. It's not surf culture. Nobody wears a helmet. Meanwhile, people are getting hit by their board. Like 50% of accidents in surfing, the board hit them in the head. Board hit them in the head. I mean, their fins, you know, hit you. I mean, wear a helmet, for God's sakes. Yeah, I'd wear a helmet. I have earplugs that are working now. That's a miracle. CVS pharmacy, CV, no, CVS store, CVS. If you want earplugs, you have swimmers there, go to CVS. The ones they have, at least the ones I got, they work. You corkscrew them into your ear, kind of, and they really seal very, very well. Plus, they have a cord connecting them. Super great, man. And they're cheap, really cheap, like $5 or something. I've spent so much money trying to get earplugs online. None of them work. And the expensive ones don't work. They don't. It's really insane. These cheap ones work great. They're just designed properly. It's amazing. It's amazing. They have a sort of a central little tiny rod that's really, really firm rod that the silicone is around it. So you can take it and corkscrew it and push it under your ear so it goes in there and really seals beautifully. Whereas the other ones are just soft silicone. You can't really do that. You can't do that. So, you know, get a board, wetsuit. Earplugs, glasses are the problem. I can't see without the glasses, so maybe I have to get my eyesight better. Or he said contacts. I don't know if surfers wear contact lenses. I guess they could wear contact lenses and goggles, real tight goggles, so the water doesn't get in, you know. And a helmet, goggles, helmet, surfboard. I could do it. I could do it. I'll see what happens. But it'd be kind of fun just to fool around. You don't have to go out and be a big surfer guy. Just fool around in a little beach break here and there and just have fun. You know, it's just fun. There's beach break, it's spread out all over. There's miles and miles and miles of beach break. You could find a place where there's nobody's there. It's easy. If the waves aren't very good, nobody's going to be out anyway. So you just catch some waves and stand up and surf them in. That'd be fun. You know, I'm kind of thinking like maybe I could do that. Maybe I could put this head cover on the club. So we're just hanging out here saying that the help with our problems is greater than the problem. Oh, and this is the smart pad, some big sort of patented thing. Oh, and this is like, what is that on the, some more plastic on the bottom? Oh, yes, it is. It's some more plastic on the bottom, so I can take this off. Oh, now the cobra stands revealed. Okay. Nice. I mean, nice job. Smart pad. Yeah, I don't know what that is. It's supposed to keep your club looking like it's aligned properly, no matter what the loft is. That's the idea. And people say it works, so I'll trust them and say it works. Okay. Putting the trying to put the head cover on. Squish. It's going in. Did it go in? Not quite. There it goes in. Boom. It's in the head cover. We have a head cover. We have a golf club. And I guess you use this to pull the head cover off. Oh, that's how it works. That's a you take, pull it out, and then pull the head cover off. That's a very nice design by Cobra Go. BioCell driver. Looks beautiful there in the head cover. Awesome. Look at that BioCell head cover. Yeah. It just says bio. Oh, the cell's there, but it's in silver. You can't really see it so well. That's nice. Very nice. With the white shaft. I like the White Club white shaft like this. That's a very extra stiff shaft. I've never hit an extra stiff shaft. I've hit stiff, but not extra stiff. So I'm looking forward to seeing how this works down the road. The help is greater than the problem. The help is greater than the problem. So this is our theme for this video. The help is greater than the problem. I'm getting lots of help now. Not exactly sure why and where it's headed to. But, hey, Padmasambhava. Okay. Reading quotes by Padmasambhava last night is really cool. Wow. What? Wow. I was really so impressed. Tibetan teachers are so impressive. They really are. They impress me so greatly. Sure, there's some boilerplate involved, but still, just the compassion and the clarity and everything is just there. You can't help but be really touched by it, spiritually touched by it. Can't help it. It's really astonishing. Really, I'm in shock. Shock over it. Where did these Tibetans come from? What, you know, some kind of special rescue mission for planet Earth or something? How did they get so extraordinarily adept at it? You know, it's just, why did Padmasambhava, you know, choose Tibet, and why did this all happen? Wow, it's just, and we're becoming aware of it now. Why are we becoming aware of it now? Well, must be a really important reason, right? So we're in a really extraordinary time in the world. Maybe the most extraordinary time ever. I'm told to lay low for now because there's going to be, people are getting really desperate, but they're not ready to repent yet. They keep thinking no doubt is stronger than God's ability to free us from the delusion of doubt. This arrogance, this continuity fear keeps us arrogant. So what they will do is they'll look for someone who's able to give them concessions. Say, well, truth isn't totally true. In other words, we have doubts about truth, the legitimate doubts. So someone, they're looking for really charismatic spiritual teachers who will assure them that some of their doubts are justified. And then they'll say, oh, great, that's what I wanted to hear. And now I feel more comfortable with where we're at, which is trying to wipe out the Dharma, the non-compromising, no-concession Dharma, which is truth is true and nothing else is true. Dharma is uncompromising. That is the Dharma. Any compromise, any concession is non-dharmic, actually. So they're looking for really charismatic, non-dharmic leaders and quote-unquote teachers, etc. And they'll demand that very strongly, concession, concession, concession. We just tell us that some doubt is okay. Just tell us that some doubt is okay, because we know we're in trouble. So we got to do something, but repentance just seems too much. We just can't seem to do that. So tell us that we don't really have to repent, that some of our doubts are justified. And so the floor is open for that type of opportunity for some to become very, very famous, powerful, wealthy, worship, you know, all this stuff. The door is wide open for that. That's why it's such a dangerous time. If you have the polish in all of this, then this is a very dangerous time, because people will be throwing, you know, options to you, like, hey, you know, you could do this, you know, maybe you could do this, and you don't. So it's a severe temptation. You don't want to be tempted in that way. Only a fool flirts with temptation. The wise realize, hey, we're vulnerable. We still have continuity fear. Continuity fear makes us very vulnerable. It makes fools of us all. It makes fools of us all. So I could still be made a fool of, absolutely. So for me, I want to stay away from it. Stay away from it. I'm not going to do anything, no action for a year. No action. I'm not taking any action for a year. I'm just hanging out by, you know, me and my little lonesome self and little lonely surfer boy or something for a year. Yeah, let the ones who want to gobble up this opportunity, let them do so, right? There'll always be plenty of those who are willing to do so. But for me, I'll stay away from that. I have to stay away from it. Cannot make concessions. People are, when you're desperate, you're willing to do anything to try to extract some concessions. So that means the temptations right now are probably the worst in history. The most dangerous temptations ever in history are right now. Especially for those who have a lot of spiritual polish. They're the ones that people were going to saying, help, help, help. Where's your compassion to help us? And then working to extract concessions out of them. That's the danger of these times. Super dangerous. For me, super dangerous. So I committed to being helped by Longchenpa and company and the Dharma Kings. So they have been kind of telling me, hey, just go play golf for a year. I say, okay. I'll do it. I'll do it. For sure I will. I've done it before. I'll do it again. I can discipline my mind that way. Sit on the sidelines, sidestep the whole situation. I mean, the world is just ripe for all sorts of leadership positions right now. Tremendous amount of leadership positions are open right now. And people are going to start begging for those to fill those positions. Those who are like super charismatic, super confident, all of that with the polish and all this kind of stuff that the people can just say, yeah. We'll do what you say, we'll do what you say. Tremendous amount of opportunity there. And so, but for me, I just have to say, you know, no thanks. Just sit this dance out. Sit this dance out. You get all these people coming up to you saying, well, let's dance. Come on, let's dance. Grabbing your hand, let's dance. I say, no, I'm sitting this one out. Got to work on my golf game. Are you crazy? I just say, no, I'm not ready yet. Not ready yet. Not ready yet. Which is true, because I'm not ready for any leadership position at this point. I'm just, you know, trying to get better at apex yoga is all. But, you know, I'd have to teach apex yoga. There's nothing else I would teach. But I'm not ready to teach apex yoga, so I can't be the role of a teacher at this point. No way. Of course, apex yoga is absolutely no concessions whatsoever to the utmost extent. It's extraordinary. But I'm an apex yogin, absolutely. But, you know, still struggling with bias against certainty. People might say, oh, great, you're going to help us out, we need help. No, I'm not allowed to teach apex yoga yet. I'm allowed to student teach in a safe way like this, but not as a leadership position, no. The help is greater than the problem. The help is greater than the problem. And that's all that really needs to be said. People say, how'd you do it? Well, I did it because the help was greater than the problem. That's how I did it. That's the long and short of any explanation. Thank God I came to that today. Is all the questions that people have for you are really interesting. I've always had the suspicion that they come from motives that really are based on continuity fear and wanting to get concessions. And trying to cast doubt upon God. So they ask, well, how'd you do this? How'd you do this? How'd you do this? And I try to explain this, like, it doesn't seem to be, the answers don't seem to be, they don't take them in. It's like they're digging for something. What are they digging for? Maybe they're trying to reverse engineer it, like to figure out, like, how did you do it? So then they can cast doubt on how you did it. So the right answer is just to say how I did it was that the help was greater than the problem. That's all. The help did it, and the help is greater than the problem. And how did the help do it? Well, it was greater than the problem. That's how it did it. So, you know, the problem lost. It's gone. Lost interest. It's finished. So I don't need to say specifically how it's done. It's over with. There's no more questions as far as, you know, it's problem is done. Done with. Gone. Wow, very nice club. This is exactly the club I wanted, actually. I couldn't have found a better club. And it was all preordained for me, actually. It was all preordained. The price was ridiculously low. It was new. Everything was right. The adjustability, color scheme was what I was told to look for. Everything just fit. And I couldn't have asked for a better club. You know, this is just amazing. And I was perfectly willing to hit my old club that's, I don't know, 10 years old or something. I said, no, I'll stick with this. I don't need a new driver. Forget it. I'll just use whatever I have. But the guidance came and said, no, you deserve, we want you to have this one. Well, because I've been working out for a year and a half now. A year and a quarter maybe. Trying to get stronger and stronger and stronger so I can, and I guess, you do that, and it's just like if you practice guitar for years and years and years, maybe like I did, then you come across like a really nice guitar. I did. I came across this like 1956 Fender Stratocaster. I think it was 56. Maybe it was 58, 59. I don't know. One of the first Fender Stratocasters made. Maple body. I mean, or just, you know, natural tone wood. It was just wood. The thing was so worn. I mean, it had been played all these years. And that sounded great. I mean, wow. Old Fender tone. So I had that guitar. You know, I thought it was just awesome. Came across a Les Paul Jr., which was awesome. I had a lot of guitars that you know, really, really super sweet. I finally got a Fernandez, a Japanese copy of a Stratocaster. And man, that had the sweetest tone of any guitar I've ever heard. So I had that. So you end up ultimately getting the nice stuff. But before that, I had just junky guitars. I'll play any guitar. I said, it doesn't matter. Just, you know, give me a $35. I had a $35 electric guitar, Candy Apple Red. $35 electric guitar. I got it used, $35. I played that for years and years and years. So it's okay with me. Because, yeah, I realize I'm just practicing. So I don't need anything nice. I don't deserve it, really. I'm not good enough for it. But why have all this good stuff if you're not the man? Why have the gear that says you're the man? You know, it's just misleading. So just give me junky stuff. That's fine. So this club is like, wow, saying like, wow, you're the man. And it's like, okay. I said, wow, I'm not the man, you know. But Dharma King says, well, yes, you are. You will be. And I said, no, I don't know about that, no. But we want you to hit this. I said, extra stiff shaft, come on. I'm not some gorilla. He says, well, maybe you will be. You got to be that gorilla out there. I said, wow, all right, whatever. It means I have a lot of workouts to come, which is fun. I enjoy working out. I've been getting to like it now more and more. Yeah, what else is there to do? Eat right, work out, stay out of trouble, right? Just do that. Eat right, work out, stay out of trouble. Do apex yoga. Work out, eat right, do apex yoga, stay out of trouble. Just let that be kind of your mantra, right, for your life. Work out, eat right, apex yoga, stay out of trouble. A lot of engineering in this club head. I mean, really, and the shaft is supposed to be an insanely good shaft for this club. It's just really high, super great reviews about it. But a lot of technology, a lot of innovations in this club head. There's no question about that. And they say it shows. It shows. You'll go long with this club. They say you will go long with this one. Well, that's good. That's fine. Why not? Why not smash it off the tee? Yeah, we'll see. I never know. I never know what I'm going to do. I never put myself. I try never to put myself in a box. I try to just leave everything open, 360 degree open for what happens next. I don't know. I don't know what I'll do next. I try not to think about it. Just follow guidance. Whatever your guidance is, which is the play of attention. Just follow that. Someone called me today, and it's like, it's a robocall. I'm sure it's a robocall. You got all these robocalls these days, and I don't answer the phone, but, you know, I think, well, someone's trying to get my attention. Maybe I should just answer the phone. But there's all these, says, hey, this is Joe from, you know, such and such and such. And you know, I got this. You know, you've been pre-selected for this really wonderful cruise. How are you doing today? How are you doing today? Anyway, I said, well, I'm doing okay. Oh, that's good to hear. The robot said, oh, that's great to hear. Yeah, I'm glad to hear that. And, you know, maybe I can make your day even better because we have this really great offer to you. You interested in hearing something about this offer? And say, well, maybe. He said, well, okay, let me just tell you a few things about it. And so you think you're having a conversation with a person, and it's just, you know, software. It's a robocall. As you know, so the let me see the prefix. Of course, it's not somebody I know because 267-480-9088. I don't know what to make of that. Oh, and another thing about that dam was that our car got caved in, smashed. Someone came from behind, wham, and just caved it in. Cave in, huh? Cave in. Had to get it. Wow. It's like something. I knew when that happened, I said, something big is going to happen. Something really bad is going to happen here. Otherwise, that wouldn't happen. Why is that getting our attention so severely? I mean, I said, I thought I had protection for the car. I put it under protection, and it gets crushed. I said, something. We ended up getting a better car. Well, I don't know if you call it better, but it's more sophisticated. I kind of like that other one, actually. It's very agile, quick. The one we have now is a very smart car, you might say. Ridiculously smart car in terms of all sorts of stuff. But one thing I noticed, they don't even tout this. They don't even tout it. But it's really amazing, the gearing of the car. It's geared to go slow in city traffic. So you don't have to always think, hit the brake and say, oh, I'm probably going too fast. The other car we had, you get up to 40 like that. It was so agile and quick. And so I got to slow down. I got to slow down. So this one kind of lugs in low gear. Kinda, and so you're stepping on the gas and you're going from a stop and you're cruising along. And say, okay, I'm going fine now. And you look and it's 25. Or with a 35, you're going a little quicker, but it's still lugging and it goes up to 35 and then just kind of stays right there. Amazing job they've done on the gearing of this car. So it's really easy to go 25 and 35 as far as you don't go over those speed limits. You don't speed in cities. But then if you push the accelerator a little harder, just a little pump of the accelerator, instantly the turbo kicks in and that thing just goes like a rocket. So that's how it's geared. So if there's an emergency or you need to go fast, you just push the accelerator harder, and it shifts from this kind of sluggishness to just this, a cheetah, And I tried. I haven't floored it yet, but I tried hitting it hard going on the freeway. Man, that thing just flew like lightning. It was like people are going, slow down, slow down, slow down. What are you doing? It is really fast with that turbo, but in the city, you don't feel the turbo at all, and so it's actually slow in the city. Get a load of that. That's really impressive. That is an innovation that is useful for everybody. Great, great work there. And then lane assist, adaptive cruise control, backing up, warning, backup warnings if there's cars coming from the side, ding, 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 and blind spot warnings, automatic blind spot warnings, chimes if you turn signal something's in your blind spot, and on and on and on. I think front crash avoidance. If you're going to hit someone in front of you, it automatically brakes for you. If you're distracted or some reason you're not braking, automatic braking for you like that. All sorts of stuff. It's just really, they're making cars, more and more that way. I don't really like that stuff that much, but that's how they are now. It's not really my car, but I have, it's available. So I drive it occasionally. I drive it occasionally. It's very quiet. It feels heavy, stable. The steering is kind of firm. It's not real quick and agile. Not like a real whippy car that you'd be whipping through traffic, which a lot of people do these days. It's kind of like a cruiser that just you could take on a long trip. It's real steady, stable, very stable feeling. But if you want to get up to speed, you can definitely do that. I mean, you can just get up to high speed in a hurry. Kind of like the tortoise and the hare, as I say, our theme for this video is the solution. The help is better, is greater than the problem. The help is greater than the problem. And we do great nutrition, great workout, apex yoga, and stay out of trouble. So do great nutrition, great workouts, great apex yoga, and stay out of trouble. And go rabbit, tortoise and the hare, tortoise and the hare, tortoise and the hare. Do both. Go fast at times and then go slow down. Wow, I need to slow down. Just like that. This is how it's done. This is how it's done. What time is it? Okay. I got to make dinner. That's how it's done. It's very simple. And the simplest of all is that the help is greater than the problem. The help is greater than the problem. Just keep it that simple. That's called faith. That's called faith. This is what works. Faith works. It's either that or you think that the problem is greater than the help. It's one or the other, right? Unless you want to say, well, they're equal, and then you're going to go into really a chaotic mind state. That's what happens if you try to play that little game. So then you have to say, huh, that doesn't work. Equal doesn't work. So which is it? And I chose the help is greater than the problem. 1978, I chose that. So since then, from then on, I've been helped to an extreme extent, really. Tremendous, tremendous, tremendous help. And the help gets better and better and better. Get Padmasambhava saying, if you're a devotee of mine, I'm on your doorstep. I never leave your doorstep. He says, That's how close my help is to you. He says, I won't leave you. People say I've gone away. I won't leave you. I don't leave my devotees, he said. I'm on your doorstep. Words of Padmasambhava. Wow. I heard that. I said, oh my God. Wow. Very shocking. Very wowish. Very wowish. All right, so how have we done? Yeah, pretty good. About an hour and a half. And if you're feeling the intensity of the times, you're right in the flow of the times. It is really super intense. We have to take care of business, our spirit, our business, which is what? Great nutrition, great workouts, great apex yoga, and staying out of trouble, right? The help is greater than the problem. Help is greater than the problem. We need to stay focused on that and let the other folks be focused on what they're focused on, because we don't need to worry about that. We don't need to worry about the world, because the help is greater than the problem. And I really believe this. That's why I don't focus on the world hardly at all. I explained the damn thing because compassion. I'm not worried about it. I know that the help is going to be greater than the problem. I will be helped. I'm not going to be harmed by it. But I was sent there specifically to become aware of this problem. So, you know, I don't know how that will play out. If it's, I'm meant to, you know, make others aware of this, or how, you know, what the deal is, I don't know. But I'm certainly aware now that, yeah, this is something hardly anybody even is thinking about. I'm sure the hydrologists and geologists are thinking about it. Yeah, of course they are. They have to be. This is not a good thing to have that dam, have that lake full right now. That's a problem waiting to happen. It's a black swan event waiting to happen. If we had an earthquake like today or tomorrow, we could just have like maybe the worst catastrophe America's ever had. Make 9/11 look like nothing, really. That's bad. That's bad. So, you know, protect the dam too. Protect the dam. I think California should. Put security on their dams, actually. I really do. I think they should do that. I think that's very advisable, because they're so full right now, really full. That Orwell thing, you know, that you know, put security on dams. Come on. Seriously. And I think they do. I think they do. I mean, they have, you know, park rangers looking out for stuff, but I would say put security on the dams in the whole country, actually, but definitely California, yeah. The population is such, the Bay Area, absolutely. Absolutely. Hopefully we're out of the doldrums a little bit, you know, like this country is like saying, whoa, kind of waking up from like a long siesta and say, wait a minute, you know, we got some issues here, right? We got some really intense issues here. But again, the help is greater than the problem from God in terms of our awakening from this dream of doubt, which is what's really going on. And apex yoga is the top teaching, is absolutely correct teaching. And I have a a knack for it, you know. I fit into it. Affinity. I have a very strong affinity for it. It's like something I can do. It's definitely something. Apex yoga, I can do it. I can do it. So that makes, that's why Longchenpa introduced himself to me, because he must have known, he had to know, you can do this. He says, there's something you can do. It's just like if someone wanted to teach you to play guitar, if they knew, like, you have a real strong affinity for music, and I know I can teach you to play guitar well, you know, they would know that. It's kind of like that. If you have affinity for something, I for me, I say, yeah, I do. I can do this. I can do apex yoga. I can be an apex yogin. There's no doubt in my mind about it. So I might as well do it, right? That's what I love doing. That's what I love doing. That's the yoga I love doing. For me, it resonates as, yeah, this is totally legit. No doubt about it. Totally legit. No doubt about it. So might as well, you know, get work at it, right? Might as well work at it. It's like hitting this golf club. I might as well go out there, you know. Well, might as well work at it and at least work towards it, you might say, work towards it, which I'm doing. I'm doing more exercises, golf exercises, you know, swinging the core and building up the hands, the wrist, the forearms, and just so the overall strength in the shoulders, and then the core and the turn and the legs. I just overall, I'm doing these exercises that keep building up more and more strength, more and more strength, more and more strength. And then some speed exercise. I introduced some speed exercises today where you just try to whip something very light, like a golf club, just so you get used to turning real fast, like the motion of like just whipping through really, really fast. And that helps you get used to the idea of a super fast swing, super fast swing. Which is important because you're doing heavy weights, you're swinging real slow, and you get used to swinging slow. So you have to do both of those exercises. What's a dumbbell? I have like 10 pounds or something. Or a kettlebell, I don't know, what is it, 10, 12 pounds or whatever. But then I have barbells, like 30. And I was like swinging that today, and it felt kind of light for me now because I'm getting stronger. Swinging that, and that this builds up your strength. It really builds it up over time. But be sure then to use the fast, you know, tortoise and the hare, there you go. Slow, building up strength, powerful strength, and then fast twitch muscles, building up the real fast swing through, so you get used to just whoosh, whipping it through like that. It gives a sound, you whip something through, whoosh, like that. It's like, you can hear it, and if you do it faster, it's a higher pitched sound. If you do it slow, it's whoosh. And you're real fast, whoosh, like that, whoosh, what does that sound like? So you can tell, am I doing it faster or slower? But whatever you do, whatever you have affinity for, right? But hopefully here, the ones here have affinity for apex yoga. There are some here who have affinity for apex yoga. There's no doubt about it, right? So go for it. I mean, be an apex yogin, right? That's what's hip for you right now. That's what's hip for you. So we have our little what's hip thing going here, right? Little apex yoga culture going on here, which is great. It's fine. We don't need to be some big movement, you know, that's so many retreats and conventions and gatherings, and there's all these thousands of people, you know, and we're hanging out in this famous location in India or somewhere. No, we don't need to do that. We don't need to do that. We can just have our little apex yogin culture here. That's fine. But it's just that, okay? It's just that. So let that be understood. It's just that. We're apex yogins, okay? We don't stray away from that, because we want to get good at this. You know, if you want to get good at playing guitar, guess what? Don't spend all your time playing piano, okay? Spend your time playing guitar, and vice versa. If you wanted to get really good at piano, you wouldn't spend all your time, you know, a lot of time, I gotta practice guitar today. If you want to be a great pianist, practice piano, and forget about the guitar. This is just a discipline, okay? And take this from someone who was a virtuoso pianist and also a very, very good guitarist in this life. Pianist was the previous life. This lifetime, I said, I did the piano already. I want to play guitar. And so I set the piano down. When I was young, I took piano lessons and I was very good. And I knew I could become a virtuoso again, but I don't want to. I did that. So I said, I want to switch. And so I switched from the piano over the guitar. And then I spent all my time practicing guitar, sometimes 10 hours a day. And I got really good, not virtuoso, because my health got bad. And, you know, I was more interested in the spiritual path. I said, you know what? I don't really want to become a musical virtuoso in this life. I want to be a spiritual virtuoso. So I started backing away from the guitar thing. I could have become, you know, a guitar virtuoso or so, whatever you want to call it. I could have become that, but I didn't really want to. I saw something better than that. I said, no, there's something way better than that. So I eventually quit guitar for a long time, and then I went back to it for a little bit, but just to learn singing, actually, is accompany myself singing. I didn't play lead guitar anymore or anything. I was just simple chords, you know, strumming chords and sing. I did a lot of singing work. And then I said, well, I'm not really good enough to be a really virtuoso singer. I'm not, I can do it in a certain way, but it you know, the tone of voice is not quite, you know, what it needs to be, perhaps, you know. There's some people just certain have a certain sound to them, you know. And so I said, oh, that's okay. It's a lot of fun. But apex yoga is what I'm really interested in. Really, really interested in. This is what I'm focused on. So we're not doing other stuff other than that. You know, we've got to make that very clear. We're not doing other stuff. Just apex yoga. And, you know, I have to be aware of who is, you know, ready for that. Who is ready for it, right? Because some will think, well, maybe I can get them to do something that I'm in, what I'm interested in. No, 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 no. I'm interested in apex yoga. That's what I do. And, you know, it's like, let's say you're a guitar teacher, and someone says, I want to learn how to play classical guitar. And I say, well, I play country, you know, or something. Or I play blues or rock and roll or something like that, or jazz, whatever. I don't want to teach you to play classical guitar. I mean, go to a classical guitar teacher. There's many of them. Okay, so go to a teacher that's the right fit for you. It's very important. And then you'll feel like this connection in terms of you're part of this culture, you know, cultural connection. So apex yoga, cultural connection. I feel it. If it's there, I feel it. Like, oh, this is an apex yogin here. Good. And then it's like, it's just easy, right? It's just, because we're, you know, if you're like playing rock guitar, you're jamming with other people who want to play rock guitar, it's easy. But somebody starts playing classical guitar, you say, you know, we really don't want to do that. I mean, it's fine if you want to do that, but here, you know, we're focusing on this. And then everybody has a right to focus in on their culture, their little subculture, right? We have a little apex yoga subculture here. There's not many that are doing it, to tell you the truth. Not many. This is a Longchenpa's thing, apex yoga, okay? There's Dzogchenis, you know, here and there, very few, but there's a few. But they're not really focused on Longchenpa's apex yoga. I'm focused on Longchenpa's apex yoga, okay? Really am. I really am. He has his own style, his own, and it's very wonderfully clear, and Padmasambhava helps out. He's also an apex yogin, Padmasambhava, really, really, when you really boil it down, you know? But Longchenpa's the supreme adept at apex yoga. He's a supreme adept, so he's mine, and this culture is, he's the guy. That's all. Some people, Ramaharshi's the guy for that inquiry yoga, okay? That's fine. That's great. I love Ramana. I pay attention to him all the time. All the time. All the time. He's in a supportive role, very supportive role. All the Dharma kings are. But my interest really, I feel best at, I really, this apex yoga, I really get it. I really get it. I'm really getting it more and more and more and more and more. I said, yeah, I get what you're pointing at. I really, it's very clear. It's very clear. And I've been working at it, you know, really, very, very, very intensely working at it. So some progress is coming along, which is great. All right. Speaking of apex, you know, this driver's supposed to launch it really high, and then the ball flattens out with low spin, and it just seems to carry forever. This is what it's supposed to do. And then with that sort of flatness, as it flattens out, it tends to come down. It doesn't balloon with a low spin. It doesn't balloon. So as it comes down, it runs out quite a bit too. So that's where you get the mega yardage, the 300 plus yardage, is that with that additional run out. I mean, if you can carry it 280 or something in the air, you might get a run out of 20 yards. That's possible, right? And then you got your 300 yard drive. So can I hit this 280 in the air? Good question. Find out. Because that's probably pretty much what it would take, 280 in the air. What's that? The prefix of this number is 267. 267. So can I? Maybe I need to hit it. That robocall. Maybe I need to hit it. 267 in the air. With on a. Hard, fast track. So if it comes down the right angle, what was that run out? 30 yards, 33 yards? It's possible. If it's a little bit downhill, it's possible. If it's a hard, hard fairway, and it's kind of got some slope, you could run it out 33 yards. Yeah. If it comes down the optimum angle, big, you know, big first bounce and a hard fairway. Now, a soft fairway, of course, it wouldn't work. No way. But yeah, it could run out. Not if it's uphill, but if it's a little bit of downhill slope. So 267 in the air, there you go. what's the next number? 48 run out. What would that give you? I don't know. 270, 118, 315 yards. Ran out 48 yards, maybe 315, I think. Yeah. 315 yard run. Okay, so let's hit it 315 yards. Let's do that. It's part of our little apex yoga culture here, actually. What I do, just again, we work out great. We have great nutrition. We do great apex yoga, and we stay out of trouble. And we lay low. We kind of keep a very low profile. So we're not, you know, available for anything else. Maybe we'll go play golf. And it's part of our exercise and sublimeness. It's part of, you know, could be part of it. Sure, why not? Okay, very great. 315. Hit it 267 in the air with coming down real hard. Coming down real fast. Not ballooning at all. That's like a hard carry. Comes down with a lot of speed, then runs out on a real fast track. 48 yards, there's 315 right there. It's only 45 yards away from 360. Okay, yeah, very great. So, apex yogin, you're just say, I'm an apex yogin. That's what I do. So I don't, you know, stray, and we try to stick with, you know, Longchenpa pretty much. So I mean, that's where we get back to whatever we're listening to, Ramananda Sagara Maharaj or whatever. We come back to Longchenpa. We come back because He's the one. He's on point with this. You know, he's so dialed into it. The supreme adept of apex yoga is Longchenpa. And so I just want to play, you know, that style. I want to make sure I'm really, really good at that style. Really good at it. A pro at it, you know. And so if you want to be a pro at a guitar style, you really need to practice that style a lot. You know, you have a different rock style, rock and roll, hard rock, speed metal. You know, they have all these different styles. You really got to specialize and practice it really, really intensely in order to be really great at that style and have your style. So don't try to practice all styles intensely. You know, you've got time to focus in on one style and says, okay, let's really get this one down. So apex yoga, Longchenpa's apex yoga. Very great. That's it for this one. And I'm going to put this driver in my bag now. Absolutely. It's where it belongs. Very great. That's it for this one.